A very, very interesting talk, a very, very interesting colloquium. It is a privilege for us to have with us Professor Juan Rousseau. And it's not the first time that he visited the Institute. I know, I remember some time ago, we had the opportunity to meet Juan. Despite that, there are so many years now, but I would say that he was one of the pioneers with Chema Torreyes and other people here in Spain, I would say, that they were pushing forward for the incorporation of Spain to the those time was the MMA multimillimeter array, and later it was ending with the incorporation to Spain to ISO via ALMA, what is today ALMA. But the CV, the curriculum vitae of Juan is so long that I'm going to say just a few things on that. I think it's a privilege for us to have said that. And he was born in Germany, but he has been living in Zaragoza for a while. Now he finished the physics degree in Zaragoza, and then he moved to Madrid and to perform the PhD. The PhD was done with Fernando Rañada in Madrid. And then later on, he won a fellowship from a Fulbright fellowship, and then he moved to the States, and he has been there since then for a long while, and he has been in Princeton and Virginia, Berkeley. But we know him for his contributions in radio astronomy, and he has been for a long time linked to NRIO and ELA, and so he has been working mainly in relation to, I would say, the interstellar medium galaxies in general. Just for two spots of his career, I can mention, for instance, that his interest in what he's going to talk today about the cosmic UV background and the correlations that he discovered, correlations in H1. And just mention to end that with that is as early as in 1984, he was one of the persons that actually was able those days to impose a serious upper level to the, those days called anisotropies on the cosmic microwave background. And that was 1/10^5. It was very stringent those days, and then that they were later on confirmed. So by other experiments, of course. So yes, ending here, I think it's a privilege for us, Juan, to be with us, and I'm eager to learn from the living on the edge for this galaxy. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for that very kind introduction. You will probably notice, so I may as well say it anyway, that I don't really know any astronomy, so please be kind. this PhD that Pepe was talking about was done in mathematical physics, and I've been winging it, as we say in the US, ever since. Anyway, I'm going to talk about super thin galaxies, which I use not, I mean, they're beautiful, and I like to watch them, but I don't really know much about them. I use them as laboratories to test other things. And I feel like bringing aceitunas to Jaén because there's people in this audience that know much more about these galaxies than I do, right? So anyway, let me start with some knowledgements. What I'm going to tell you about the research in super thin galaxies has been done in collaboration with Lynn Matthews, who was briefly a postdoc at the NRIO, where I was for 25 years. We need an algorithm to treat data, incorporating systematics to control the systematics. I do that kind of work with Bill Cotton on and off. And I'm going to tell you about work we started a few years ago on detecting the ionizing UV background using the edge of a super thin galaxy, hence the living on the edge pun. And that's done with Josh Adams, who was a graduate student of Gary Hill at the McDonald Observatory at the University of Texas. And there are some some references there. I will give Emilio a PDF when I'm done, if anybody wants to get to the subjects. Okay, super thin galaxies, what are they? They're diffuse, low density disks with minimal dust absorption. They're very blue, low metallicity, so very unevolved. Very large gas to star ratios. So they haven't made many stars, which is why they're in some sense very primitive. But they're not making many stars now either, so they'll spend their whole life without making stars at the rate of more grown-up galaxies. They have large ratios of dynamic mass to gas or stellar mass, which is actually why I became interested in them. I was working on the dark matter problem at the time, so these were galaxies that had extreme problems of dark matter. So, what are they? Well, to me, they're simply bulgeless spiral galaxies, which have very low surface gravity. So everything happens very slow and nothing happens very big. But aside from that, they're like any other galaxy. And they're also very simple, which means one has a hope of understanding them in order to use them for physics experiments. If I say something in English which somebody doesn't understand, please ask me. I can talk in Spanish as well if you want to, but then it would be very bad because I don't know how to say many of these things in Spanish. But so we could switch if you want, it's up to you. So this is an example of super thin galaxies. The initial criterion of Karakhanchev, who drew the first catalog of flat galaxies, or he called them cigars as well, was basically a minimum ratio between the two diameters of 10. So it has to be flat enough that if you take the ratio of those two things, you exceed 10. Otherwise, I wouldn't think that this was very flattish, but yeah, if you measure this diameter and measure that diameter, it's still above 10. So I will argue later on that that is actually a perturbed super thin galaxy. This is UGC 1281, that one is IC 2233, this is UGC 7327, and that's UGC 3697, which has been studied by people in this audience. So we observe these with the VLA, which is an interferometer, which takes images with spectral resolution, so you actually get cubes of images, a plane after another, each one of them at a different frequency, which corresponds to a different velocity correction, Doppler correction to the hydrogen line, which is how we do the kinematics. And so how does this work? The voltages on each antenna are multiplied, and that turns out to be a sample, give you a sample of the Fourier transform of the image. Big words, by no means evident. And as a matter of fact, Martin Ryle, who got the Nobel Prize for inventing this, tried everything before he tried this. The first thing he did was sum the voltages, but that's very unstable. So full of systematics. Then he found out that if he multiplied them and took an average, he got the same thing without the problems. And so that gives us samples of a Fourier transform. Again, big words. And my students, when I tell them that, get worried about it, and I tell them not to. And the reason not to worry about it is you don't have to do the Fourier transforms in your head. The computers are very good at doing that. And so we are lucky that when you multiply the voltages, you get samples of a Fourier transform, because we give that to a computer and the computer makes the image. Well, it turns out that this is analogous to observing through a lens or through an optical telescope that is covered and has just a bunch of holes. And I will show you how that works, because I can try to make an image by taking this big telescope. Imagine I take GTC or the telescope you have at Calar Alto and cover it and start making holes. The first image is simply the image that comes out of using the interference pattern of two of those holes. You get a sine wave, right? It's the same as a young two-slit interferometry experiment. The next one is two other holes at a random direction adding a second sine wave, and then another sine wave. And that's actually how an optical telescope makes an image. It's just that by the time you're finished, you've covered the whole dish, but you can interpret it or imagine that it is the product of using, or the result of using, holes all over the place and adding all those interference patterns. That's what a radio telescope does. When we take the data with the individual telescopes, do this product and store it, what we're doing is taking the amplitude and the phase of each one of those sine waves. And what we do when the computer makes an image is put it all back together, adding it all up, and that's how the image is made. What your eye does when it makes an image, and what an optical telescope does in the lenses that, or mirrors that give you the image at the end. It's exactly the same thing. And again, the good thing is that the computer does it for you. Furthermore, we don't have money to put telescopes everywhere, so we put them in a random positions, if possible. ALMA is much more random than the VLA. At the VLA, they have to put them on train rails, and because of that, they're in a line. But now when the Earth rotates, as seen from the celestial source, this whole thing rotates. So 1 hour later, you get a different pair of holes in your mask. And by the time that 8 hours have passed, this arm has rotated to this position, that one to that position, and that one to that position, as seen from the source, and you've essentially covered the whole thing. Of course, if the source changes what you're doing, that you're out of luck. So you're only seeing the constant part of the source. But there are techniques for getting the rest of it. Okay, so my first example is UGC 7321. I will convince you, I hope, that this is a wheel seen on edge. So it's 1 degree from perpendicular to the line of sight, 89 plus minus 1 degree. If you had it face on, you wouldn't see it. The surface brightness in blue is 23.7 magnitudes per square arc second. And I can convince you of that because it turns out that this thing here is a background spiral, which is seen through the disk. So they also don't have much dust. A little bit, so there's a little bit of reddening to this thing, but this feature here is a spiral galaxy which is behind. If it was behind a regular galaxy, you wouldn't see it because the disks are normally much thicker. These things are very thin. I have a quantitative way to show you this later on, which I will. There is no continuum radio emission in this galaxy. We haven't been able to detect it. And the far infrared luminosity is 8 times 10 to the 9 in solar luminosities. 8 times 10 to the, no, 8 times 10 to the 7 in solar units. So it's almost not seen in the infrared either. It all works out to support a picture where no bright stars are being made, therefore no supernova, therefore no cosmic rays, therefore no dust emission. So this is a galaxy which just sits there. We know it is rotating, and how do we know it? We know it because if I show you one after another one, these images that we make, I think I can show you. At every frequency, at every Doppler correction, you see that the galaxy over here is going away from you, and then on this side, it's coming towards you. So the hydrogen redshifts into a different channel. And this is the signature of something which is rotating around. When the size is the minimum, that's when you're going through the middle. And the reason why that's the minimum is because you're only seeing the gas that is going at the same velocity as the average of the galaxy, and that has to be perpendicular. So you're only seeing the very small line of sight where the gas is going perpendicular to you, which is a good way of finding the kinematic center of the galaxy. Now, there's a number of algorithms to detect the hydrogen. You add it all up, and that's what it looks like. This is the optical galaxy. it's probably not easy to see, but the hydrogen extends about 50% further out. It's very thin. It has a half width of about 100 parsec only, although there are filaments going up to 1.5 kiloparsec. Big debate on whether that's going out or still falling in. Okay. A few graphs here. This is the total hydrogen spectrum compared with a spectrum taken from Arecibo. So this is at every frequency or at every velocity, all the hydrogen there is. This is the same that I was showing you in the previous image with the red galaxy in the middle, which has some H alpha in it. And this is a position velocity plot. So along every line of sight, you catch hydrogen at different velocities depending on where, at what radius the hydrogen is. If you take the average of that, you would get this rotation curve, which would be wrong. So for galaxies which are edge on, like the Milky Way, you have to look for the terminal velocity, because there is velocity at intermediate values simply from the projection. So the real rotation curve for this galaxy is given by the envelope, this and that. So it has a rotation curve like the Milky Way, except with an amplitude of 100 kilometers per second instead of 250 or 230. And this is the projected gas mass, which is less than, I can see the units there. Can't remember what the units are, but this is the Kennicott criterion. So in a standard sense, you need gas, a surface gas column density which exceeds this in order to be able to make stars. So it all hangs together. There is so little gas and it's so puffy that it doesn't make stars, which is why it looks the way it looks. Okay. And this is the rotation curve obtained from the envelope. It is normally said that interferometers don't have much resolution. So my beam size here is 12 seconds of arc, 16 seconds of arc, depending on how I put my taper. But my signal to noise is so high. This is one of the most sensitive H1 images obtained with the VLA. Signal to noise exceeds 120. So your kinematic location is that width of your beam divided by the signal to noise. And this image has the rotation curve in H1, and these pluses are H alpha rotation curves, which are obtained with a seeing of better than a second of arc. And lo and behold, they agree, which basically tells you two things. First, that the kinematic accuracy of the H1 is sub arc second. It also tells you that the galaxy is thin even in H alpha, because otherwise you would be seeing the frontal side of the galaxy, and it would not be the one that corresponds to the rotation curve. So the fact that these two agree at all radii, whenever there's a little bit of dispersion, it's because there are some minor H2 regions, right? So there's a few ionized gas with some turbulence in it. But in general, the agreement is very good, and that tells you, like I say, both things. First, that you have that kinematic location or localability from the H1, and second, that the galaxy is optically thin even in H alpha. Okay, one can do a mass decomposition in the standard way. They're assuming a cold dark matter halo or an isothermal halo, provide, give the stellar mass, the maximal mass or the minimal mass given the colors that you have, and compare that with the data. And this is the sum of these components. These are the stars, this is the gas, and this is the cold dark matter halo, or the pseudo-isothermal halo. The sum of that is this dark line, and the line I'm highlighting now is what the data are actually telling you in H1. So none of them work. Towards the center of the galaxy, none of them work. In other words, the rotation curve doesn't rise fast enough for the data that we have in it, for the models that we have in it. So these galaxies in the inner 2 kiloparsecs are a big problem for cold dark matter. In other words, there's no way to assume there's a cusp, there's a potential well there. There's no bulge, and so the hydrogen is really tracing the potential without any wiggle room, and it's simply failing. So super thin galaxies, amongst other things, and amongst using them for the uses I'm going to discuss with you today, are also the worst problem for the cold dark matter scenario. Nobody knows how to make them. They're so low density that there is not enough gravitational attraction to make them in the age of the universe. So in 13.4 billion years, and starting with the cold dark matter potentials, we don't know how these things could ever have been made. So problem for cold dark matter or a problem for cosmology, I don't know. I tell my students often that cosmology is like a house of cards. Everything seems to work, but none of it makes any sense. And then there are problems like this one, which we don't know how to explain. But as Landau used to say, cosmologists are often wrong, but never in doubt. So if you read the press releases, we know exactly how the universe works, even though it doesn't really work out in the details. Okay, enough for now on this galaxy. I'll go back to it. This is our second system. IC-2233, Markarian 86. This was also observed by people here in Madrid, in Complutense. They were thought to be a paired system. I will argue that it's just a chance superposition, so that it is an absolute super thin galaxy. Markarian 86 was assumed to be a blue compact dwarf galaxy. I will argue that it is also a spiral galaxy. And there were a bunch of experimental reasons why this field was hard to observe in the radio and prompted some of these developments we have to do once in a while. And this is a map of the radio continuum. The galaxy is here, so again, no continuum from it, but there are two extremely bright quasars here. And I will show you in a bit the ghosts that you get because of that. And so you have to deal with them. And this is Markarian 86, which has some continuum, some H2 regions and some star formation. So this is the problem that you get because of having these very bright sources, which are on low points of the beam. But you can deal with that and get very clean images. This is IC-2233, again, a rotating slab. This is the other one, which is also a rotating galaxy, but at an angle of about 30 degrees, 35 degrees. So it also turns out to be a spiral galaxy. Few peculiarities of IC-2233, which hinted from the beginning that there was something abnormal with this galaxy, meaning interesting. The most important one is, this is again the total hydrogen as I showed you before, a very thin disk, and then stuff coming up to maybe a kiloparsec to the sides. But if you look carefully here, in a spiral galaxy, the velocity contours, because of the rotation that you get, have to be like open Vs on both sides, and that it is here and here, but all of a sudden, the contours here have a twist in them. So you get from the very regular contours that correspond to rotation to here having a twist, where this one is going up on this side and down on this side. So when we looked at that, we realized that there was something unexpected with it. It's also different from the super thin galaxy I just showed you, where we had a flat rotation curve exactly like the Milky Way, to this one, which rises much more slowly and it's sort of more like a solid bar rotation. And the reason why these contours were inverted was because the galaxy shows corrugations. Now, of course, you know much more about corrugations here than I did when I started, and probably than I still do. Again, people possibly in the audience, this was Sánchez Saavedra with Eduardo Bataner and collaborators who wrote a paper indicating that integral sign warps were ubiquitous. Essentially, these galaxies, the moment they run out of stars, there is nothing to keep the gas in a plane and it warps. It's just an instability. The corrugations were first observed in the Milky Way by Gum and then by Kerr, who were trying to determine the plane of the Milky Way to make a good galactic coordinate system, and they found that depending on where they looked, the hydrogen was up or was down. So they realized that there was a wave going on in the Milky Way, and that actually the amplitude grew as you got away from the center. They're hard to detect. And the reason why they're hard to detect is because the average galaxy is at an inclination. And at that point, you don't know what is at what distance in going, you can, if I have a galaxy which is inclined like, say, 30 degrees, I can have an object which is on the plane or being a little closer but being up the plane. So I have two directions, two orthogonal directions to play with. And so it's very hard to do that. So corrugations are typically seen either in galaxies that edge on, like this one, or like the Milky Way, or in galaxies that are face on, which is what Emilio Alfaro and his group has done in a number of galaxies, because there you can look at the H alpha and velocity and see that some of the gas is coming towards you and some of it is going away. And you can see that there's an oscillation perpendicular to the disk. I always found it curious that there are two groups doing corrugations in Granada, separate. One group looks at edge-on galaxies, the other one looks at face-on galaxies. They use complementary techniques, but somehow they've never looked at the same galaxy, both of them. What causes this? It could simply be a gravitational instability, could be a tidal interaction with a neighbor, could be collisions with high-velocity clouds, perhaps spiral waves interacting with the gaseous disk. You could have a bar formation that simply sends an instability around. Essentially, I look at these galaxies as a drum, a membrane. Anything that perturbs it will make it oscillate. The oscillation goes up in amplitude at the edges because there's less gravity to bring it back down, so the time scales get longer. But it's essentially an instability, so anything that causes, that triggers that instability, for example, a tidal interaction, can generate these oscillations and then they dampen away slowly. In IC 2233, we believe that this is the first galaxy outside the Milky Way where the corrugations are seen as a localization. So I should explain what I've done here. You take the plane and you do a fit, a Gaussian fit perpendicular to the plane. And that gives you the centroid of the H1 layer at that particular position. Now you do that for many other points. And what you find is that if I have here horizontally the average stellar plane, I have a waviness of the centroid of this H1 layer depending on where I am. And when I get to the edge of the stellar disk, which is marked by these arrows here, then I have the typical integral sign that goes warp, that goes up one way and down the other way. But inside that, I have this oscillation. The wavelength of this oscillation is 7.5 kiloparsecs, and the amplitude is about 150 parsecs, but growing from the center. The center, the specific gravity is stronger, and so the amplitude of the oscillation is smaller. We observed this galaxy in a number of wavelengths, and this is the panel I have here. It turns out we didn't observe this, but it was available. It had been observed by Galax. We did R-band, we did H-alpha, we did near-infrared, and this is from Spitzer, which we did as well. And to our surprise, we could see it in almost all tracers where we had some sensitivity. The two longest wavelengths of Spitzer, we simply have no resolution. So, you know, they're in here simply for completitude, but there's nothing I can say about it. But in all the other graphs, you can see that this is the H1, and here the line in every one of them is the best fit to the H1. And you can see that the R-band, the stars, the H-alpha, The near UV, which is this one, this is the far UV, which is a little displaced, and even the lowest bands of Spitzer show an amazing correlation. On the northern side, which is the side to your right, the correlation breaks down a little bit, but that's where there's a clump, which is the H-alpha, bright H-alpha region in the galaxy, bright H2 region in the galaxy. And so we went through the arguments, time scales. We believe that this is simply a gravitational instability, probably due to a modest bar formation in the middle, simply agitating or plucking the drum, right? This is a composite. There's, again, a couple other quasars in the field, Markarian 86 and IC2233. We tried really hard to blame these corrugations on an interaction with Markarian 86, and we couldn't. First of all, the best distance and getting distance to these galaxies is very hard. They're close enough that the Hubble flow distance is not good enough, right? They have peculiar velocities. For IC2233, Julian Dalcanton and Anil Seth used Hubble to do a good HR diagram, and from the tip of the red giant branch got a distance which is about 10 megaparsec plus and minus 1. We did Tolly Fisher work to Markarian 86. We think the best guess is 7 megaparsecs plus and minus 1, so they're not really interacting, they're just a chance superposition. But it turns out that each one of them is outside the flat part of the rotation curve of the other one. So even if they're passing, it's not a bound system. Right? So even if they're passing, it's a one-time passage. They'll never see each other again. So it is unlikely that Markarian 86 could be responsible for the corrugations, and unlikely that IC2233 could be responsible for the bright burst of star formation. That Markarian 86 has probably just eaten up a neighbor. You know, it's a completely different beast. But that's our best guess. Okay. Finally, my third galaxy is UGC 3697, the integral sign galaxy. You can see it's really puffed up, and so the first thing you could say is super thin, really. Well, again, if you take the diameter to the width, it's more than 10. So technically, it still goes into the classification. Big argument as to what the distance to this galaxy is. Super thins can only stay thin because they have no strong neighbors interacting with them. They have so little stars, so little specific gravity, that if a big neighbor goes by, they basically get destroyed. And so, because they're isolated, you cannot rely on their neighbors to get the distance out of it. So all the models for the superflows and, Tolly et al. Models don't give you distances for these galaxies. The Vaucouleurs placed it at 18 megaparsec, but if I just take the Hubble distance from its redshift divided by the Hubble constant, it should be 40. So I remember the Vaucouleurs also wanted Hubble's constant to be 125. So if I just take the 75 we believe today, or 70 we believe today, it should also already be at 30 megaparsec. That has a tremendous implication, because masses grow like distance squared. So I've just multiplied the masses by a factor of 4, if I do that, right? So it has to be taken like a grain of salt. First, it was a super thin like IC2233 and UGC 7321. Now I'm talking about something which is about half the Milky Way. It's all of a sudden a much bigger galaxy. So that's the effect of moving them further away. But still, it's our best guess is this 30 megaparsec, which still leaves it a peculiar velocity of about 1,000 kilometers per second, high but tolerable. Okay, this is H-alpha obtained from WIN. So here there's a lot of star formation, and I hope to convince you in a few minutes on why this has happened. There is the radio field, and here you have the plane of UTC 3697. It is a healthy emitter of radio waves, so there are cosmic rays, there's synchrotron emission coming out of this galaxy. So we observe it in H1 again, and there you see the rotation, but look at all those things popping up. Turns out to be in a group. So this one has neighbors. Here there are interactions, right? So beginning to understand why it could be warped. It has suffered an interaction. If I add all the hydrogen, that's the picture, and I draw your attention to this thing here, and I will argue in a few minutes that that's the corpse of the galaxy that destroyed it, or the galaxy that caused the war, right? Let me skip that. All right, some properties. Stick them at 30 megaparsecs, maybe it would be 40, but then it gets even more massive. 30 is probably okay. Slow rotator, only 95 kilometers per second. Again, we're talking about a mass comparable to the Milky Way, moving at about, you know, Milky Way moves maybe at 300 kilometers per second, or sorry, 250 kilometers per second where the sun is, right? So that's the flat rotation curve. Here it's 95 instead of that. Still thin, so only 220 parsecs across, 10 to the 10 solar luminosities in stars, a little bit less in hydrogen, and a dynamic mass which is 10 times bigger. This one actually has comparable far infrared emission to emission in starlight. So again, it has had a lot of activity, a lot of stars, a lot of H2 regions, and a healthy star formation of about a solar mass per year. This is the velocity field. This is UGC 3697 and its neighbors. These were both known. They have UGC numbers. I think I have this. These were previously unknown group members, and these were previously uncatalogued dwarfs. So these galaxies were known but not known to be in the group. The fact that they have hydrogen at the same velocities tells us that they're neighbors. These were not known, they're three dwarfs. And then there's some residual radio continuum emission, which are those two red things from quasars we simply haven't imaged well enough. This is a large field. Okay, I'll show you some channel maps. And the reason why I show you these channel maps is this is, again, a Doppler imaging technique, which tells you this is the hydrogen moving away from you at 31-37 kilometers per second. This one is moving at 3,094 kilometers per second. All those planes correspond to different velocities. That's the systemic velocity. That's the velocity of the center of the galaxy. And you can see there's an anomalous blob with almost more hydrogen mass out here than what is at the center of the galaxy, and a plume that comes up from it. This previously unknown dwarf has 3 × 10⁷ solar masses of neutral hydrogen, and this is an optical image, and there's indeed a galaxy there, dwarf galaxy. So our scenario is that this galaxy has gone through here. In doing that, has dropped most of its hydrogen on the plane as it went through.
Do you have independent estimation of the distance for this galaxy, or you are considering that they are the same distance of the farther one?
All we have is the redshift, right? No independent distance determination, so I couldn't tell you whether this thing, if I take the galaxy as a slab, there is no way I could argue with you whether the collision was in the plane of the graph or at an angle. No clue. This one could be slightly behind or slightly in front, depending on how the kinematics went. Simply don't know. But, and we also have obtained CO, and there's also a little bit of CO coming up this plume. So what we believe, like I say, is this galaxy impacted over here, left most of its gas. It's 10 times more gas here at the wrong velocity, kinematically speaking, than what is left with it, and went back a second time, which is where the tail originated and this extension of NGC 3697. So we believe that this is, as I was saying before, a drum that now has been hit by something that went through, and you see it oscillating as a result of that. Okay, so as Jerry Selwood and in his calculations has shown, the next stage of this would be that the whole thing puffs up and makes a normal galaxy, not a super thin galaxy, and there's profuse star formation to be formed. So we're catching this galaxy at a certain time in its evolution, and it will never again look the same. And probably before this collision happened, it was just a flat, quiescent galaxy as the ones before. This is basically what I just said. We believe that the present state must be rather short-lived, and the galaxy will soon undergo significant structural changes. Okay, let me take the last 10 minutes or so to tell you about the edges of galaxies. And you can see how theorists, when the solar neutrino problem happened, there were always measurements of lack of solar neutrinos with large error bars from Ray Davis, and theoretical calculations which were always within sigma, but with a much smaller sigma. And so as these experiments went better and the limits went down, the theoretical calculations always kept up with them, but were mutually exclusive, because the error bars were always so small that every calculation said that the previous theoretical calculation was wrong. This happens here too. This is NGC 891. Is it NGC or UGC? Don't know. NGC 891, I think. Spiral edge on. And for many years, this was the picture of it. And you see these contours are the H1 contours. Lack of sensitivity. The lowest contour was 5 × 10^20 atoms per square centimeter. Then they observed for 100 hours with the VLA and couldn't make any more contours. So for a while, the lore was that you only have hydrogen at column densities above 5 × 10^19, because when it gets below that, it gets ionized. In other words, galaxies are bathed by the cosmic UV background. So these are the photons that come from the AGNs in the universe, the starbursts in the universe, which are redshifted and come to you, but still have enough energy to ionize hydrogen. There's enough of them, it was thought, that you cannot have hydrogen in a galaxy at a column density below this threshold, because it'll be ionized. you'll be back around. Very low brightness, wide field images, you know, 32 magnitude. That they have a strip along the galactic equator, which the celestial equator, which they should compare with the alfalfa strip to see whether there's anything really, you know, one of these galaxies seen face on. You would have to see a 15 second of arc faint diffuse structure, and you will have to see a huge amount of hydrogen, all of it at the same frequency, but it probably should be trying.
It's a curiosity. Remember the, well, of course, the Shyama neutrino decay theory for is disregarded now. I mean, what's your opinion about that?
I don't hear anybody talking about the standard model. It's like the whole herd of news and zebras stampeding the same way, right? No, nobody else talks about anything else.
But your data are so unique that maybe you...
Licia Verde in Barcelona was talking the other day about problems with the standard model. Okay. She's beginning to explore that. I think these things will come back into play, but the success due to WMAP and Planck has been so spectacular for the standard model that any alternatives for the time being are not being considered. Yet there's a lot of things which don't really match. And so, I mean, if we were honest, we would say the whole thing is a house of cards. It looks beautiful, but it reminds you of 1894 when Lord Kelvin said that physics was finished and all that was needed was to measure six numbers with higher precision. And of course, they had the ether, right? Space was tenuous but had the properties of a crystal. Okay. And somehow that didn't bother them, right? So I don't know. I mean, the whole thing really could be. It's harder this time, right? Remember, when Einstein wrote his theory, he had to verify the Michelson experiment, right? These days, if this theory of cosmology is wrong, they will still have to provide the acoustic peaks in the microwave background, and so it's a much much harder thing to see how it would be replaced.
Sorry.
You said that you are not able to fit the curves, taking into account the dark matter scenario. Have you or anybody else tried to do a la Milgram?
I don't. And the problem with Mond to me is that I don't see how one can do Mond with a straight face, because we only explain the universe because we assume the Copernican principle and we assume that physics is the same everywhere. If physics is not the same everywhere, then I don't know what to do. I'm done. So if you use Mond or these non-Newtonian theories of gravity, you're assuming that somehow F equals ma morphs into F equals ma squared, nobody knows how. If I do that, then there's a lot of what we're doing that I cannot do, because I no longer know what the dynamics is. And so I don't want to do that. In 1986, we were desperate because we needed dark matter. We had no clue how to do it. By now, many measurements of dark matter, all of them give the same amount, and the amount that explains Big Bang nucleosynthesis is exactly the amount we need. The trouble is on the way we acquire dark energy, and nobody knows what to do with that, right? So it's a bigger problem, but it's one that Mond doesn't touch. But the dark matter itself, I don't see how you can have exactly the same dark matter at redshift 1000 than what you need here. And say I'm going to try to explain it with a theory which only works for small galaxies. Doesn't work for groups, doesn't work for anything, and certainly doesn't explain why we have the same amount of dark matter. You know, how I could have the Big Bang nucleosynthesis if I have no dark matter. Because of course Mond says there is no dark matter, it's the dynamics that's changing. For this kind of galaxies, I prefer to think that that's telling us that there's an integral constraint on how a small galaxy forms, which we haven't understood yet. So it's a constraint on a galaxy formation theory. I should also say that These galaxies I've shown you have a signal to noise which is from 50 to 100 times better than the ones that they use, McGow and company use in their graph. So they use my data, but blowing up the error bars by a factor of 30. Because otherwise they fall off the graph significantly. I mean, these galaxies fail the Pauli-Fisher relation because they have a lot of gas and not enough mass in star. So they've used them and they've had to degrade the error bars because otherwise it doesn't work. But you know, I admit that I'm biased. If I have to throw away Newton's law, then I cannot do cosmology. So
thank you very much.